With respect to withdrawal, do you want to designate with or without prejudice?
Without prejudice.
Good motion, second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Any additional changes? Counselor?
Mr. Chairman, I have one that I would respectfully ask as a time-sensitive matter. As a new, I guess that would be item three on old business, and that would be for us to discuss the city-county water contracts. I will take a unanimous vote of Commissioner Evans' refuse, Mr. Chairman.
When you say item three, according to my old business, one, two, item one, two, okay, and that's three. I'm waiting now. Water contract?
Yes, sir.
There's no discussion.
I just said no.
Second.
Good motion on the second. There's no discussion. Please vote on the motion. That passes 4-0. Commissioner Evans refused. Thank you. Anyone else? Doug?
Mr. Chairman, public hearing number eight. I'd like to have a public hearing this evening. We may or may not move for a decision tonight. Just want to announce that. Public hearing number eight.
So after we have a hearing, we'll possibly make a motion to delay a decision?
Yes.
We need to vote on that now or at the time?
At the time is fine. It's just an announcement.
Thank you. Thank you. Doug, I think you're going to say something.
I am.
If there are no further changes, is there a motion to adopt the agenda as... Counselor, there was a talk that we might need executive session during this meeting.
That may be a byproduct of the recently added old business item.
Okay, do we need to add something about executive session for this agenda?
Though the agenda already provides for executive session if needed, and I may ask the board if you're willing to go into executive session at the end of the meeting.
Okay, thank you. Is there a motion to adopt the agenda as modified?
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Announcements and reports.
I do, Mr. Chairman. Is Edward Monroe Eustace the third here at Sept? Would you care to come down to the podium, please? Good evening. Thank you for coming in this evening. This is a resolution by the Board of Commissioners of Forsyth County, Georgia. To Edward Monroe Eustace the third, his fellow scouts, scoutmaster, and all the leaders of Troop 3143 in the Atlanta Area Council of the Boy Scouts of America, and all persons to whom these presents shall come, greetings. Whereas Edward Monroe Eustace III is a resident of Forsyth County and a senior at Lambert High School, and whereas for his Eagle project, Edward Monroe Eustace III constructed a nature trail for Riverwatch Middle School that provides opportunities for students to experience nature and to study wildlife and plant species that are native to the area. And whereas, in conformity with the requirements to attain the rank of Eagle Scout in the Boy Scouts of America, as determined by an Eagle Scout Board of Review, Edward Monroe Eustace III has been found worthy of promotion to the rank of Eagle Scout. And whereas, in honor of this achievement, an Eagle Scout Court of Honor will be held on September 30th, 2012 to officially bestow upon Edward Monroe Eustace III the rank of Eagle Scout. And now, therefore, be it, and it is hereby resolved that the Board of Commissioners of Forsyth County, Georgia, in recognition of the honor bestowed on Edward Monroe Eustace III, does hereby express its pride in his earning the rank of Eagle Scouts in the Boy Scouts of America, and best wishes for the future. Be it further resolved that a copy of this resolution be recorded in the official minute book of the Board of Commissioners, and that a copy of the same be presented to Edward Monroe Eustace III in testimony whereof we have hereunto affixed the seal of the County of Forsyth, State of Georgia, and signatures of the members of the governing body thereof, given at Cumming, Georgia, on the 6th day of September, 2012. Congratulations.
Public comments, Julie.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and members of the board. We would like to take a moment to review the meeting procedures. Please silence all cell phones and electronic devices. Please refrain from disrupting the meeting through general outbursts, applause, or comments. All comments shall be directed to the entire board and not to a particular commissioner. If you have documents with the commissioners, please provide those to the clerk. If fewer than 7 copies are submitted, only 1 copy will be retained by the clerk as part of the permanent record. Those who wish to speak must sign up by completing a public comment or public hearing form available just outside this room. Information regarding specific requirements to address the board is listed at the podium. Please state that information prior to speaking. Per the county's broadcast policy, the county is not responsible for statements made during public meetings and does not warrant the accuracy of such statements. The public comments portion of the meeting is intended to allow speakers to make a verbal presentation to the board. The number of speakers is limited to 10. Speakers are selected on a first-come basis and will be heard in the order in which they sign up, with the exception that Forsyth County residents will be heard first, with non-county residents to follow until the allotted time has expired. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. The public comments portion is limited to 30 minutes. With respect to the public hearings portion of the meeting, each side, those in opposition and those in support, are allotted 10 minutes to speak. Each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. We have 2 public comment speakers signed up this evening. Our first speaker is Julian Bowen.
It's bad when you walk 20 feet and think you've done something. There's 2 things I'd like to talk to you about, but before I do that, I want to congratulate Brian Tam for getting elected for the 3rd time as District 2 Commissioner, and only one of the first has ever been elected more than that in the Board of Commissioners. And I'd like to congratulate Jim Baugh for getting re-elected as the sitting chairman. Never in my memory, goes back to 1980, that a sitting chairman has been re-elected. And of course, with over 62% of the vote, that's something to be proud of. The first thing I'd like to talk to you about is the water contract. And after the situation we found ourselves in now, there's almost no way that the board and the council can come together on this. You have a signed letter of agreement, and really the best thing is for both the county and city to go before a visiting Superior Court judge and let him fill in the details of what that is. It's going to be a situation. If you try to put all the finished water through that one water plant, that's going to be a massive increase, and you're going to put public safety at risk if that's done. You can have a pipe that ruptured. I imagine the pressure is going to have to be increased because it's all going to be coming out of one area instead of the other plant, and you could have a fire with no water pressure in the county, and then of course it's just aggravating for people not to have water pressure. And there's no hard feelings, and I've talked to the mayor many times over the past, 15 years, and we've worked on a lot of things together. And I understand it's tough for the county to be so big and dominant that And you gotta also look at the situation on age. I'm 65 years old, and I'm an old man. And I can tell it every time I walk. If I was on the city council, I'd be the youngest man by 6 years. These guys have put a lot of time and effort in their public service, and they're tired, and they make mistakes. And there was a reason why Bear Bryant was forced to retire from the University of Alabama when he was 70. There's a cutoff point in which a man has to step back from the forefront of what's going on in the community. And these people are trying their best, and it's no fault of their own. So you've got to understand that a Superior Court judge, a visiting Superior Court judge, can fill in the details of the contract and do this in a situation where there's no more animosity. Now, the second thing I'd like to talk about is a local option sales tax. I came over to Forsyth County for the first time in 1968 or 1969. I can't remember what day it was. For a basketball game. I'd already graduated from high school. My girlfriend was a cheerleader, and I was riding the school bus. And I was amazed at how the community was. The local option sales tax is something that you need to seriously think about. Fire protection is the number one responsibility with law enforcement of an incorporated municipality. And without a fire department per se, the city of Cumming is caught up basically to where they should be.
Wayne, can you hold on for a second? Do we wish to grant more time? Is that exceptional? About how much more time? How much more time do you think you might need?
Not very much. I'm about finished.
A minute?
A minute would be fine. I'm sorry to run over. I don't have a prepared speech. Okay. The other thing that I was mentioning is there has to be a phasing out. If a community, a city, does not have a paid fire department, and that's one of the prime reasons for having a city, and we have a county fire department that's paid for separately and administrated separately. The local option sales tax, you have to get away from the actual numbers, and you have to go back to what each project that would fund. And there's been a lot of, and what's really, really disturbing is no talking between the council and the commission. When the 77 acres was bought on Pilgrim Mill Road recently, and John Hurd didn't have a real reason to buy the property, we've been through the water plant acquisitions and things like that in Coa when I was growing up, and you don't move a water plant. That's just something that doesn't happen. So you're looking at a sewer plant on Pilgrim Mill Road, and we have so much sewer capacity that it's almost impossible to think that has to be done quickly. And I've overrun my time, and I'm sorry. Congratulations once again. It's always good to have people re-elected. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Our next speaker is Hal Schneider.
Good evening, commissioners. My name is Hal Schneider. I am a resident of Forsyth County, and I'm here speaking for myself tonight. As you all are well aware, the mayor has threatened to turn off the supply of raw water to the county as of October 1. That's a little more than 3 weeks from today. While I applaud the concept of bringing in a judge to fill in the details of the contract, I don't think that's going to happen in 3 weeks. And we have a crisis on our hands on the 1st of October. I would strongly urge this commission during item 3 of old business, which was added to the agenda today, to present, vote on, and approve a motion to petition the court for an injunction restraining the mayor from turning off the water on October 1. As Julian mentioned, this is and could be a serious public safety issue for the county. Secondly, I would like to reiterate a request that I've made a couple times before, that any commissioner that has a conflict because of business that they are doing with the city or their spouse is doing business with the city should recuse themselves from any negotiations on the water contract. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
That was our final speaker, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Jody. Adoption of the minutes. As Chair intends the motion to adopt the minutes of the regular meeting and executive session of August 16, 2012.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Chair intends the motion to adopt the minutes of the work session and executive session of August 28, 2012.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. Please vote. And that passes unanimously. Chair entertains a motion to adopt the minutes of the special call meeting of August 28, 2012.
So moved.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. Chair entertains a motion to adopt the minutes of the special call meeting of August 30th, 2012.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. Please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. And then the consent agenda. Chair entertains a motion to adopt the consent agenda. It was not amended as far as the consent agenda.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. Public hearing number one, request approval of an alcohol license, Director of Planning and Community Development.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, public hearing 1A, it's application AL120573. This is located in Mission District Number 2, and is a request for approval of an alcohol license for MR Alpha LLC, DBA Toscana, name licensees, and Shell and Doyle, for application to sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, and wine for consumption on the premises at their place of business located at 4090 John Street Parkway, Suite I. The application is consistent with Ordinance 68, therefore a public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff.
Thank you. Chair would entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0 with Commissioner Levin coming back to the room and voting that passes unanimously. Is there anyone here to speak in favor of MR Alpha LLC doing businesses to Tuscana? Michael L. Boyd.
It's Michelle.
Michelle, my apologies.
That's okay. Please, still the time.
Please come up. Yes, ma'am.
We're open a family Italian restaurant. I have had another restaurant for the county for 11 years. And we are going to consumption of premises with the application for almost all. And all partners with its family request to have this change.
Okay. Any questions? Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is there anyone here who wishing to speak in opposition? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. This is in District 2.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. It's my understanding the application is in order. And I would just like to say to Michelle, at the back of the agenda, there are seven groups here tonight whose alcohol licenses are in jeopardy. Please be familiar with the Forsyth County Alcohol Code. Okay? I would move that we approve the license for Michelle Del Doyle, the application of sell distilled spirits, malt beverages, beer, and wine for consumption on premise AL120573. Motion to approve.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Item 1B, Tom?
AL120575, Commission District Number 3, the request for approval of an alcohol license for Murphy USA, Inc., doing business as Murphy Express, number 8662. Name licensee is Alphegas and Wells, for an application to sell malt beverages and wine by the package at the place of business located at 4515 Atlanta Highway. The application is consistent with Ordinance 68. Therefore, a public hearing is recommended by staff.
Tom? Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Is Alphaeus here or anyone from Brookfield Oil?
Yes.
Would you like to speak in favor of this? You don't have to, but if you would like to, you can. Anyone else wishing to speak in favor of this license? Anyone wishing to speak in opposition to this? Seeing none, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. District number three.
License name is Alphaeus Nobles. Application to sell malt beverages, beer, and wine by the package. Alcohol license 120575.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Item 1C, Tom.
AL120572, located on Commission District Number 1. Request for approval of alcohol license for Cachelet LLC, DBA Hop Inn, number 16, Shell. Name licensee is Akbar Babani. For an application to sell malt beverages, counter by the package. At the place of business located at 2310 Rob Raymond Boulevard, Suite B. The application is consistent with Ordinance 68, therefore, a public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this license? Is there anyone who wishes to speak in opposition? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. And we are at 1D, Tom.
Thank you.
I'm sorry. Thank you.
It's my district.
It's your district.
Yes, sir.
I apologize. Pete, what do you have to say about that?
Tom, is this their first store or the second store? Kennedy, you know?
I'm not aware of them having another store in the county.
I just want to agree with Mr. Tam. I hope they know all the rules and regulations pertaining to alcohol. On that, I'd make a motion to approve Hop Inn number 16 Shell. The name licensee is Akbar Bahamut. The application sell malt beverages, beer, wine by the package AL120572.
Second.
We have a motion and we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. We are at 1D, I believe.
AL120574, located in Commission District Number 2. The request is for approval of an alcohol license for S&R Mart, Inc., doing business as Chevron Foods. The name licensee is Asim Asani for an application to sell malt beverages and wine by the package. At the place of business located at 7730 McGinnis Ferry Road. The application is consistent with Civil Ordinance 68, therefore a public hearing is warranted and recommended by staff.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. Is there anyone here wishing to speak in favor of S&R Mart? Is there anyone here wishing to speak in opposition to this license? Seeing none, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. This is District 2.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, is there anyone here representing S&R Mart Incorporated? It's my understanding the application is in order, therefore I move to approve The application for S and R Mart Incorporated doing business as Chevron Foods, name and licensee is Ascene Asani. The application is to sell malt beverages, beer and wine by the package AL120574.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously, which brings us to item number two.
Item number two is AL120113. The applicant's Public Supermarkets doing business as Public Supermarkets, Inc., number 1227. This is located in the Commission District number two and is a request for approval of a change licensee to Joseph L. Lundy at their place of business, which is at 3120 Madison Airport Parkway.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this license? Seeing none, is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. District number two.
Thank you. Are there representatives here from Publix? There are. All right, as I said earlier, I just want to point out that there are seven different groups here tonight whose alcohol licenses in jeopardy. Please familiarize yourself with Forsyth County Alcohol Code. It's my understanding the application is in order, therefore I will move to grant the change in individual name licensee to post Bell for me for Public Supermarkets Incorporated, DBA Public Supermarkets, Inc., number 1227, for an existing license to sell malt beverages, beer, and wine by the package. This is AL120113.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. We're on to item three, I believe.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, public hearing number three. This is the second public hearing on a code change to our alcohol ordinance that would focus on simplifying the alcohol renewal process. Our current license is granted, an alcohol license is granted for a calendar year, and we currently have an October 1st deadline for the applicant to submit the renewal application along with the associated fees. That leads to a public hearing in front of the Board of Commissioners in late December, and that is our current process. In talking to surrounding communities, identified that most surrounding communities, if there are no changes in the renewal, process it administratively. And a very generic summary of the proposal before you would do just that. If there are no changes in an alcohol license, it would be eligible to be renewed administratively. If there are changes, depending on the scope of those changes, the renewal would either come before the Board of Commissioners as a renewal or be processed as a new application. Additionally, criminal background checks that are currently required every year for a named licensee or partner would change to they're only required every other year. Would also be eligible to pay that by credit or debit card when in the past it was a certified or cashier's check. This, at the end of the day, is less administrative work for the staff. It is fewer agenda items for the Board of Commissioners. And for our applicants, there is a major benefit in shifting that deadline later in the calendar year. And the renewal fees, which are significant for some businesses, are pushed closer to the date of the actual license initiation. As I mentioned, this is the second public hearing we have scheduled. I'd ask that you conduct the hearing, try to answer any questions you have, and if you find it appropriate, it is ready for adoption. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Chair will entertain a motion to open the public hearing on this item.
I move.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone here wishing to speak in favor of the proposed changes to the alcohol ordinance? Is there anyone here wishing to speak in opposition to these changes? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. What is the pleasure of the board on this item?
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to approve proposed changes to the South County Alcohol Ordinance Number 68 pertaining to annual renewal process. Is that presented by Tom?
Second.
It's presented by Tom.
We have a motion?
We'll make sure we got it.
We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, and that passes unanimously. We are on to item four.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, item number four this evening is a second proposed reading of ordinance number 68, Forsyth County Alcohol Code. This pertains to a potential modification to add section 2.9, which would allow wine tastings in retail package outlets that are otherwise authorized to sell wine and malt beverage, but not distilled spirits. This is a second reading this evening. If the Board of Commissioners is comfortable with this modification, they could adopt. The central components of this modification are as follows. The wine tastings in these outlets will be conducted in a separate room capable of being rendered completely inaccessible from the remainder of the licensed premises, and therefore they will be considered a separate premise. Number two, the wine tastings may occur in more than 8 days per month per outlet. Number three, the wine tasting should be limited to 2 ounces per glass with no more than 8 ounces to be served per day per person. And number four, on the day that any wine tasting is to be held, the outlet must, from its opening until closing, post a conspicuous location on the outside of the premises a legible written notice stating that a wine tasting pursuant to the Forsyth County Alcohol Beverage Ordinance will be occurring at this outlet on this date. As mentioned previously, this is a second public reading. After the public hearing, the Board of Commissioners is comfortable you may adopt. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Is there a motion from the board to open the public hearing?
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone here wishing to speak in favor of the proposed modifications for wine tasting?
Mr. Chairman, my individual capacity on this. I do think this is a good change to the alcohol ordinance. We've already lost a very high-end wine store in South County due to difficulties and literally having to set up two shops, two separate doors that you go into. But I would make a recommendation to the board. It seems like we're still biting, trying to eat this elephant bite at a time, and it still has a lot of difficulties where we're having to monitor. You can only have 8 months, and you only serve so many ounces a day, so it seems like it's setting up either a system of gotchas or someone can make a mistake and give 10 ounces instead of 8 ounces. But it also prevents folks who sell wine and people want to come in and want to taste it and buy it. My recommendation to the board would be, let's do what the state requires us to do. The state allows minimum wine tasting, let folks do that. And I certainly understand you want to prevent somebody from going in there and tasting wine to where they're just getting free drinks. We certainly don't want that from a public policy standpoint. But on the other hand, we're all adults, and if folks have a license to sell beer and wine, then I think we ought to trust the proprietors and let the licensees put their license on the line. Let's just do what the state requires as the minimum without throwing additional hoops for folks to jump through the county. Thank you.
I think that was in favor, sort of. Does anyone else wish to speak in favor? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. What is the pleasure of the board on this item?
Yeah, do you know what the state minimum spending change is?
The overriding state prohibition that I'm aware of is the notion that the consumption of alcohol is not supposed to occur on the same premises as the retail sale. And so to that extent, I think we are being fairly liberal in allowing basically it to occur on the same floor area, but divided to render it a separate premise. So I really think that from the standpoint of what the county's trying to do, we are trying to lean forward and allow this in a way that doesn't result in folks having to rent out two separately complete spaces.
What about
with respect to the amounts, I don't know with the state law. I can't tell you affirmatively where I stand right now. The state law speaks to that one way or the other.
What is the purpose for number four?
Quite frankly, because if there's no notification that there's a tasting going on, the enforcement will have absolutely no way to determine any of the other elements as well. I mean, already we're talking about limitations on the amounts of quantities, but if there's no notification that a wine tasting is occurring, how would we know, for instance, how many of the days per month they've used, for instance?
We're kind of relying on the wine store to report itself on. Kind of
there's no question. I mean, there's no question there's an element of that. I mean, certainly, you know, to the extent that enforcement wanted to go out and try to really take a keen eye, like you see sometimes in some of our administrative hearings where they basically set up folks who are trying to do stings, you know, that could occur. But the reality is enforcement's a challenge. And we're going to have to rely on the providers to get it to be.
Would you feel comfortable if we struck 2, 3, and 4? Or do you think we'll just leave it as is? Would you feel uncomfortable doing that tomorrow?
The only reason I would ever feel uncomfortable is if it is prohibited by the law, but I'm not sure that it is. To the extent that the board, as a policy decision, is comfortable striking those, I will not even hazard an opinion on that. But from a legal standpoint, I'm not able to tell you right now whether that is legal or illegal to do that.
I mean,
we find
the limit, trying to not be a bar, just a wine tasting. I mean, most people just pour for wine tastings, what, great, 1 or 2 ounces?
2 ounces, man.
Yeah, so.
I don't know about 4. Is 4 necessary? I think so. Do you think 4 is necessary?
I think otherwise
you don't know about 1, 2, and 3.
I'm not going to have not look for it if we don't change it. But yeah. I think that, again, we've taken an idea that's a good idea, but we've allowed bureaucracy to get a hold of it and trying to.
I wouldn't tell you. All we do is ask to post a sign.
Just to announce that they're doing it.
Yeah,
that's all they're doing is announcing.
Yeah, they may want to announce it for advertising to begin with.
Because there will be those in the community who want to know how many times they're doing it.
Yeah, I mean,
they do. Somebody's going to need to answer.
I said, I'm not going to not vote, but I just think that we would have bureaucracy to get a hold of it.
Aren't you afraid
of too much stuff?
Are you afraid somebody's going to show up the video to see whether or not they've posted?
People are not afraid. We're used to it.
Do people follow people with video?
They do.
Right.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we accept, or that we, yes, accept and make changes to the alcohol ordinance number 68 as presented in our welcome by the county attorney.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Item number 5, county attorney.
Mr. Chairman, item number 5 is a first reading of proposed modification of the Forsyth County Ethics Code, ordinance number 77. This is a fairly substantive modification to our code that will disband the Forsyth County Ethics Board as we know it, and will replace it with a new operational methodology wherein a sitting board will no longer exist. It will be replaced by an ethics panel that will be assembled on a case-by-case basis. It will be assembled, or the assembly will be comprised of 3 individuals that will be maintained on file. These will be attorneys. These will be attorneys that all have offices out of the county, and otherwise, as set forth with some specificity, can have no affiliation or basically connections to Forsyth County. There will be a pool of these attorneys that will be sort of qualified every year. The pool must be no less than 9 or more than 15. The minimum qualifications for the attorneys are set forth in Section 2 of the code. And whenever the county receives an ethics complaint, there will basically be a blind drawing of 3 from this pool that will then be comprised or to form the ethics panel. that ethics panel will then hold the hearing or conduct the hearing in a manner that is similar to how we have conducted or allowed hearings to occur in the past. So that is sort of the big picture, the paradigm shift, if you will. We still will have an opportunity for the ethics panels to issue advisory opinions. That is the one accommodation. You know, right now we've got a sitting ethics board that can issue an advisory opinion. Well, if someone wants an advisory opinion under our ethics code, you could assemble one of these ethics panels. Now, a couple things to think about. Number one, in Section 6, members of these ethics panels will be paid a per diem for each meeting or hearing, and they will be provided that per diem for each day of the hearing, and that per diem will be approved by the Board of Commissioners. And it may be that we want to approve that in advance so that you're not approving per diems on a case-by-case basis, but sort of set one for the year, and that's the model that we use. A lot of the language in this proposed modification you have seen before, and it is the same. Some of the powers of the ethics panel will be different than the Board of Ethics. For instance, in Section 7, we're not going to have the ethics panels establish procedures, rules, and regulations governing its internal organization. Quite frankly, since they're set up on an ad hoc case-by-case basis, it makes a lot less sense to do that. Also, as to number three, under Section 7 duties, the ethics board may make investigations as it deems necessary to determine whether any violation is violated, this article, etc. Not only am I unaware of that ever happening before, but of course that makes a lot less sense with a ad hoc ethics panel that's assembled on a case-by-case basis. They're just, practically speaking, would be no opportunity for them to launch their own investigation. They will be truly a tribunal set up to hear case-by-case ethics complaints. The only other significant thing that I want to bring to your attention is the fact that if you were to approve this ethics panel concept, the board has also authorized me to also strike Section 17, which was the wrongful use provisions of the ethics code. Those are the provisions that said that if there was an ethics complaint that was found to be frivolous, etc., there would be a cost-shifting mechanism to go against the complaining party that would be stricken in its entirety. The code would still contain that methodology whereby someone that had drawn a complaint, an elected official or a county employee, if they prevail, can seek to have their attorney's fees paid by the county. That would still remain. But the notion of being able to seek cost shifting against the complaining party, if this is adopted as I have drafted it, that goes away. All of it. Mr. Chairman, this is the first public reading this evening. The board cannot adopt this evening. Thank you. Is there a motion from the board to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone who wishes to speak in favor of the proposed amendments to the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance?
Good evening, Commissioners. That's some nice ties y'all are wearing up there. It's casual evening for the rest of the world out here. My name's Brent Meadows. I have a little bit of experience with ethics. I, like Commissioner Tam, had an ethics complaint filed and subsequently it was dismissed for technical errors. I'm a little bit concerned that we're going to remove the ability of this board to do an investigation on their own. If there is a proposal or a complaint that's made and it's dismissed on technical errors, I think that the panel should be able to make a determination, well, the technical errors here do prevent us from moving ahead, but we see something and we want to investigate further, and then their hands would be tied. So I think that's very important for you to do that. Hold on 1 second. No, Mr. Mayor, I can't tell them that. But other than that, I'm in favor of this ordinance, and I hope that you'll consider a passage with a few modifications to allow that board to be able to do some further investigations if they deem necessary because of some technical deficiencies. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak in favor?
Commissioners, I'm Dan Wolf. I was on the first ethics panel and take that issue very much to heart. I see some wisdom in the changes being proposed. I have a question. Was there any discussion about whether or not we could have a couple of people within the residents of Forsyth County that would also serve with the three attorneys from outside the county? So that's the question I have. And I wonder if perhaps that brings some local wisdom, maybe. And yet, even as I say that, I can realize that, you know, we're trying to separate local undue influence from an ethics issue. So, you know, there's a downside to that. But I'm just wondering about that. Thank you.
You? Anyone else?
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Nydia Tisdale. I live in Roswell, Georgia. I think this is a wonderful idea, this ethics panel that you're considering. One thing I would suggest is that in addition to complaints, in the case of one particular commissioner who wondered if they did in fact have a conflict of interest, they were able to go to the ethics board and get a review, an opinion, an advisory opinion. So I would suggest that the ethics panel have that authority to be able to render an opinion as well. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Any other comments? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Ken, do you have any comments?
No, just to, with respect to Mr. Wolf's concern, to the extent that you were to contemplate expanding the panels to add some local citizens, certainly that could be done. Y'all will need to consider that. I will just say that's what we are coming away from, but I think the notion would be that if you had the outside influence, that perhaps it would mitigate any concerns about that.
I think that was one of the reasons I asked you to do this, because we want to remove that.
Okay.
The pressure put on both citizens when they've been friends and family and supporters and employees and family works here and all those. And that, when we heard about it in another jurisdiction, I was the one brought forward and said, this is a great idea to do here. I think that is, it's nice to have people participate, but in this particular instance, I think it's better to have disinterested people reviewing it.
With respect to the advisory opinions, that tool is still in the code of the draft with respect to this ethics panel. And finally, with respect to the independent investigation or independent investigative powers, that could be reinserted. There's no particular reason that was taken out. That was not a specific direction from the board. Just as in drafting it and taking away a standing board, the way I was reading that was something that the standing board would have the ability to do. I really hadn't contemplated that the ethics panel might find a concern they wanted to investigate and just didn't feel like they had the tools to do it. So if you want to consider that.
That's another issue. I don't believe that the ethics panel is a police panel, it's more of a review panel. If it's a technical issue, the complaining party certainly can be filed a complaint. So I would not support that. The judge and jury don't go out and investigate crimes, they just listen to the evidence. And that's where I feel this panel needs to be. I need to be a police.
But we can't take any action.
That's correct, Mr. Chairman.
So that no objection from anyone going on to item number six.
We
closed the public hearing, have we not?
Yes, we did.
Thank you.
Public hearing number six, application BA120035, Magnolia Residential LLC, which is located in Commission District Number 2. This is a public hearing for Magnolia Residential LLC regarding the request for variances to the Forsyth County Unified Development Code Table 11.2B to allow front yard setbacks of 20 feet and a minimum of 20 feet between foundations on the lots in the Gables and Stony Point subdivision. The request involves lot numbers 1, 3, 4, 16, 24, 25, 26, 27, 60, 61, and 68. Property is located in the Gables at Stony Point Subdivision, not Stony Point Road.
Thank you, Tom. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman. Ethan Underwood, on behalf of the County Residential. You're requesting a state of variances, two variances specifically. This property is located off of Stony Point Road. You can see it's a split zone. The area up in the northwest portion of the property is zoned West 4. The remainder of the zone is 3. So we file an application requesting for respective setback reductions. But the very short request is we're asking to be able to move the houses so that they have a minimum 20-foot front yard setbacks. That's in addition to the 12-foot right-of-way, which you'll have, so we have at least 32 feet between the back of the curb and the front of the homes. We're also asking to reduce the setbacks. The code has actually been approved. When the zoning originally occurred, you had to have 10-foot side yard setbacks. The code's now been changed, which we're utilizing to have 5-foot setbacks, but you still have to maintain front side yards, which have to maintain 20 feet between the structures. We're asking for a variance to use 20 feet between the foundations. So you're really looking about a foot and a half on each side of the home. I did submit to Mr. Davis, you have copies of a letter of support, particularly from the property owner of Lot 17. That house has been constructed. The remaining homes are still owned by the developer and are under construction permit, and we're asking for flexibility. Again, 16 is the one we're particularly discussing with the side yard setback, and then we're asking for 20-foot front yards on all of them as well. We have submitted in our application, I won't bore you with the visitation, but these are the criteria. The reason that we are asking for these is the property is they don't call it Stony Point Road for no reason. It's very steep topography. It's hard to cut into the back of the property, and we're trying to actually give some backyards and some decks to these. We would respectfully request that you approve these variances. The engineering firm representing Magnolia Residential is here as well. If you have any questions.
Thank you. Anyone else wishing to speak in favor? Is anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. This is a District 2 item.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve the request on behalf of Magnolia Residential LLC for a variance to the UDC to allow lots 1, 3, 4, 16, 24, 25, 26, 27. 60, 61, and 68 in the Gables and Stony Point subdivision to have front yard setbacks of 20 feet and a minimum of 20 feet between foundations.
So that's for discussion. Tom, just want to make sure, are we in any area regarding the fire rating stuff, or because the 20 feet we're good to go? I think that's where we are.
We're fine. We always have the building code that we rely on, and regardless of distance separation, there are performance standards that are appropriate that will be applied.
Okay. Thank you. Any further discussion? If not, then please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Item number 7.
Public hearing number 7 is application AZ120122. This is amendment of zoning conditions located in Commission District number 3. Public hearing is for Keith M. France regarding the addition of condition number 15 on zoning application 2532 to allow the exterior yard setback of a PUD zoning to be 35 feet instead of the approved 50 feet. This is Lot 52 in Freedom Creek at Liberty Subdivision. The condition as requested is shown on your screen. The property is located at 560 Washington Way in Freedom Creek at Liberty Subdivision, Lot 52. And was zoned PUD by the Board of Commissioners on August 13, 2001.
Thank you. Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is there anyone wishing to speak in favor of this zoning condition? Please come forward.
Thank you.
about it.
All right. We are requesting to modify certain conditions on a property that was zoned back in 2008. It took us a while to get through that. In particular, we were working with the neighbors that reside around West Scary Lake. And they expressed a lot of concern in 2008, and as they maintained that concern about maintaining water quality. So we spent a good bit of time, and we appreciate all the time and the give and take that they've worked with us. Property is under S4. It's off of Brookwood Road, across from Vaughan Drive. What we're asking for is to be able to make some modifications to the 41 lot setback. This is shown as the track. In fact, we want to emphasize, you can see the blue line that runs down along the eastern portion of the property. Protecting that stream is particularly why we have some engineering that we feel really important. This is the current site plan. This is what was approved in 2008. And probably the key issue revolved around what is labeled as lot number 41, which we've got highlighted here. This currently is a buildable lot. A house could be put on that property, but it would require crossing a stream. Kevin Holmes has acquired a contract on this property, and we feel that this proposed site plan is better environmentally, and it still preserves an economic benefit to the development. Again, key though, notice this area here, lot 41 goes away. It's relocated. There still will be 41 lots in the subdivision, in this portion of the subdivision, but this area that requires crossing the streams, if this is approved tonight, will go away. However, there were several zoning conditions throughout this tract that referenced that lot 41, so we've actually modified that. In bold print, you can see what we labeled as problem issues in development. One was a fencing requirement that required certain fencing along particular locations, particularly separating the open space from the rest of the development. That's in condition number 7. In condition number 27, again, it referenced the site plan, so we want to make sure we're referencing the ones, if you approve the ones approved tonight. And then again, in lot number, condition number 31, it said that lot number 41 is site plan specific. Well, a site plan specific lot that says you have to build a house on it would prohibit the open space. It's used for open space, so we need to modify condition number 33. So what we have before you, and again, this is a summary, but I'll walk through it, but these are identical to what was shown by your staff. One, we would identify where the fencing would be. One's along the northern boundary, along the entire northern boundary of the property that's currently required by the conditions, and we'll maintain that requirement. Section B, we're actually relocating some of the fence. It's going to be further into the wetland area. What the intention is to keep people from traipsing down into Rest Area Lake. There's no right to use Rest Area Lake. That's actually a private lake. So what we're trying to do is move the fence further into the wooded area so you don't see it. It doesn't become an eyesore for folks who are trying to buy a lot. But it still has the same effect as it's keeping people out of areas they're not supposed to be in. Again, letter C is the same intention. We also, there is a buffer. There's a 100-foot buffer required by condition number 29. And what we've agreed to do is put a fence along that buffer line. No trees will be removed, but it also gives the adjoining property owners, Patrick and Susan Foster, who I believe I saw Ms. Foster here tonight, gives them the ability to access the property. They said that they wanted to make sure no one's in the clearing. So there's a gate that would be put on this. They have the right to go over the view and make sure no one's putting anything in the buffer that's not supposed to be. Again, number 28, you see the bold text. That's what the change is that we're just specifically referring to tonight's site plan. Number 33, again, we're changing the site plan reference, but we also specifically state that nothing can go in the open space. No picnic tables, no hardscaping, no walking trails, it has to be made for a condition number 34, we're asking the board to approve this for a private gated subdivision. So this is Rose County Road at 19. Condition number 35, we've agreed with the Fosters to do our best to preserve some hardwood trees. There are some good size oaks, but there are economic incentives in the tree ordinance to maintain. It costs a lot of money to do recompense if you don't have to take them down. But we want to maintain the flexibility in the event that you get some topographic challenges out there. And then finally, we had a request from a resident of Cane Creek Subdivision to make sure since this is, this subdivision's amenities is the Woodlands, that there's not going to be an act amenities here, a swimming pool or a playground. And we requested to confirm that those folks won't be coming across the street to utilize Candy Creek's act amenities. The site plan, this is what was on file, but it specifically highlights the location of the stream, saying there will be crossings on the east of the stream, and this is attached as part of the exhibit in reference to this, as the exhibit A to the conditions. With that, Doug Stahl with Kingdom Homes is here. We're happy to answer your questions, Mr. Chairman. And we'll reserve the remainder of our time. Thank you.
Is there anyone else wishing to speak in favor of this?
Good evening, Commissioners. My name is Susan Foster. I live in the Raspberry community, and my land adjoins the subject property. And we have been working with Doug Strong with Kingdom Homes and Mr. Underwood to come up with these conditions, and we ask that you approve them as we've developed that.
Anyone else? Anyone wishing to speak in opposition? If not, is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved. Second.
A motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. I have a question. Any question, Ethan? I think it's item 15. I'm not sure I'm following. My concern is there was a parcel selected that there's not supposed to be any outdoor speakers on. Does that change?
No, sir. That's an existing condition. We did not ask you to revise it.
Thank you.
Ethan, yes, if I could ask you 7C. Could you scroll down to what is it? Yes, sir. I'm a little uncomfortable having a zoning condition that puts one citizen in the position of monitoring another citizen, and they don't have, you know, they're not a not an engineer or anything. There's liability issues with one citizen going on. There's a citizen from 113039 wanting to sign up this hold arms and things of that nature. I don't know why we're getting into allowing one citizen to monitor another. I'm very uncomfortable.
I understand. I think the intention is not to go do literal scientific testing. The question is people going to be doing four-wheel trails or riding around and or hacking up trees that they're not supposed to be. Our client is comfortable allowing the joint property owners to just monitor that. I don't think there's any condition.
Does that put us in the position, Counselor, that if the property owners 113039 go then break a leg, are they going to potentially come back to us and say that we were part of the party to allowing them to monitor wetland streams and buffers?
It doesn't impose any liability on the county from the standpoint of a premises liability issue. I'm not terribly worried about that at all.
Do you understand my concern? Mm-hmm. We're actually stating that they're going to monitor the wetland streams and buffers, and I'm uncomfortable. I know that your clients are late,
but both property owners agree.
Yeah, they mean late.
Then why don't they, once they have a side agreement and we not put it into the county's, why are we getting involved?
Because there's no liability or exposure to the county, as the council just said, putting it in there.
Do you have any concerns with it?
Well, you know, I would wager that the private agreement between the parties, probably the one wanting to access, wants an enforceable condition to make sure that gate remains in place. Why it's in place, I don't know that the county cares why it's in place. I think that's your point, Commissioner.
I'd rather just say that there be a gate maintained by the property.
And the purpose of the gate is between those two.
Whatever they want to do.
I understand that as well. So.
The only thing I will say about that is who arbitrates the day that the gate was locked?
I don't think it would be locked.
When it's locked.
That's what I'm saying. We don't need to get into the business of enforcing that stuff.
Well, that's my question to council. Well, I mean, it's a little bit of an oxymoron to have a gated or locked access gate. It's going to be difficult to access anything if it's locked. So, I mean, I think that would be something they would have to resolve amongst themselves.
They would have to litigate one another for that.
Well, but there would, the argument from the individual wanting the access is it's in violation of the zoning condition.
If I may, gentlemen, I think if we can boil it down, perhaps we run the volume to some charge or word. But I think the zoning condition simply says states the purpose of the gate. I think that we need to work with Foster's on access even. I can't imagine the county having liability for a zoning condition that says, here's a gate, here's why it exists. But I don't know that creates any particular right in itself.
It's just too much trying to put in there. We continually overreach what we should do. And I know that, you know, we try to help each property owner feel comfortable with it. And I'm okay with it saying that there'll be a gate, perhaps even an unlocked gate, Commissioner Hall. But I can't vote for this as it is, to say no. I just think it's appropriate for the county to do it.
Thank you. Just like the last half and the last things.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion that we approve the request on behalf of Camp Holmes to amend the zoning condition placed on CA 3423, place of financial report AZ 120021, and that has been displayed.
Second.
Discussion?
Yes. Just one question. I just want to be clear then, you do not wish to delay a decision?
I do not. I mean, this was something they've been working on up until today. One of the concerned property owners was showing up and spoken in favor of it. That wasn't the last correspondence I had before today's meeting, so that was the last thing I wanted to have resolved.
Just want to make sure.
So
we have a motion.
Mr. Chairman, please, to make a motion that we amend the zoning condition 7C to remove, to allow periodic monitoring from where it says to allow. So basically, again, that access gate will be installed.
I'll second that. And for discussion for a moment, just because I don't think we have the authority to give somebody the authority to periodically monitor anything.
We're giving them access.
Well, that's what I'm saying.
The zoning condition is access.
That's correct. Right. That's why if you take off allow here and monitoring, then we're not getting to the monitoring part.
In addition, an access gate will be installed.
Period. And you still accomplish the same thing.
I think it's fine. Great news.
Both parts agree to it. I mean,
The county attorney isn't jumping up and down saying take it out either.
The county attorney is not elected to represent citizens in this county commission.
We are. Okay, well, let's vote.
Okay, I believe we have an amendment and a second to strike the part about monitoring. We vote on the amendment first. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the amendment. And that fails 3-2. To the main motion to approve this. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-1. Thank you. Item number 9. Item number 10.
So we have the issue of 2595. Applicants of the Forsyth County Board of Commissioners. This is located in Commission District Number 4. The applicant is requesting to rezone 228 acres owned by James S. National Trust from Res 4 to Res 6. The property is located on the north side of Smith Drive, approximately 1,300 feet east from the intersection with Setting Down Road.
Mr. Chairman, at this time, I've accused myself of being involved in discussion of this because it involves my wife's family.
Thank you. Mr. Chairman, may I add a few more comments with respect to the presentation that Mr. Brown did?
Let me think about it. Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This matter comes to us this evening, and it's related to the subsequent settlement agreement that is under old business number 1. But right now, we're on the county-initiated rezoning component of this matter.
And let me just say at the outset, this arises out of litigation between Mashburn Trust, Mashburn Falls, Forsyth County, and Buckhorn Ventures. The actual origin of litigation goes all the way back to 2010, when Forsyth County rezoned a piece of property for Buckhorn Ventures directly contiguous to this piece of property from A1 to M2 with a conditional use permit. Mashburn Trust and Mashburn Farms then challenged that rezoning, and this is actually a component of the settlement. And I'm going to give you some ground rules in just a second with respect to the settlement, but let me say this. One of the reasons, as the litigation continued to flow, that we learned why the Mashburn folks sued was due to the uncertainty of uses that was going to occur on the Buckhorn track. Now, I'm not trying to speak for the Mashburn folks, but I do believe I'm correct when I say that, because their development as it existed in 2010 literally had development on a bluff looking right down into the Buckhorn footprint, and they were concerned that the intensity and or the uncertainty of the use that would ultimately take place on the Buckhorn site could detrimentally impact their property values, and that was one of the reasons they chose to litigate. One of the things this compromise does, and this county-initiated zoning would do, would it would increase the density on the Mashburn site, but it would also allow them to move all of the development to the interior of the property, away from that bluff, and therefore basically mitigates their concerns that they're going to have residents looking down into an M1 industrial site. I think that was the appeal of the settlement to them. I think that was the appeal of this perhaps land use accommodation for the county. So I say all that to say that's what's driving this. This is a potential settlement. This is a county-initiated rezoning. Now, I'll further say this. This is a zoning action, and you are under no obligation at all to do anything this evening. You can rezone this property. You can choose not to rezone this property. You could rezone it to whatever you believe in your discretion makes more sense for this piece of property. So you are not bound to do anything tonight. If you choose to rezone, there are conditions that are in front of you, and I will go through those very quickly. Jody, can we go ahead and what I've had on the screen is the proposed concept plan showing this Res 4 to Res 6 concept. If we can put on the conditions. The list of conditions, number one, that pertains to fire flows. Number two, sewer lines installed will be sized to serve the entire basin. Number three, sewer capacity is not guaranteed for this property. Number four, the maximum number of units allowed in development is 1,000 in accordance with the attached concept plan that was just on the screen. There is more to these conditions than I'm reading, but I've given you the gist you have at your podium. Number five, developers should dedicate right-of-way 30 feet from the center line of Smith Drive. An additional right-of-way along Smith Drive is may be required. Six, the owner or developer shall construct improvements as per the final rather than notice of decision and required VRI. And number seven, owner or developer shall construct improvements as required by the Department of Engineering to actually final configuration of the site. So I'll say all that to say those are conditions that you have the discretion to approve. You know what the zoning action is, that you have the discretion to approve, but you are under no obligation to approve it. But if you do, there are some things we can do under old business agenda item number one. So, Mr. Chairman, at this point, I think it would be appropriate to go ahead and open up the public hearing. And I will tell you that representatives of Mashburn are here if you have questions or need to ask them anything. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Is there any motion to open the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. Are you going to vote? And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Allen's recused. Is there anyone here wishing to speak in favor of this? Is there anyone wishing to speak in opposition? Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes 4-0. Commissioner Allen is recused. What is the pleasure of the board?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion that we approve the county-initiated rezoning property owned by James S. Mashburn Trust, Mashburn Farms LP,
ZA 3595, address 4-6, map 252, parcel 010, with the conditions as presented.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0. Commissioner Clemens recused. Thank you. We are then on to old business. Mansour.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, old business number one is in fact a general lease and settlement agreement arising out of the same litigation I just discussed with you. Since the Board of Commissioners has approved the zoning that you just approved, we now are in a position to effectuate the settlement agreement. This would be a full and final release between all the parties, both Buckhorn, Forsyth County, and Mashburn Farms and Mashburn Trust. Commissioner Amos, I know, will stand recused as before, so forgive me for not giving you time to say that, Commissioner Amos. But otherwise, this will be a settlement agreement that will fully and finally resolve these claims that have been pending for some time, and hopefully allow all the parties to move along, including the county, without further litigation. So I do recommend that the Board of Commissioners approve it, and I will say to you that it has been executed by both Mashburn Farms, Mashburn Trust, and Buckhorn. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Counselor. What is the pleasure of the board?
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion to approve the general lease and settlement agreement between James S. Mashburn Trust, Mashburn Farms IP, and Buckhorn Ventures LLC, and Forsyth County, as presented by the county attorney.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes 4-0. Commissioner Amos recused. Thank you very much. Old business taken off the agenda. 2A, yes. 2B has been postponed. We are at item number 3, according to my agenda, which has to do with the water contract, Council.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, thank you very much for this. This is an item that was added by way of an amendment. I'm just going to go over with you very quickly where I believe that we are. With respect to the city-county water contract, I believe I mentioned at the last work session, we do not have one. We don't have a raw water contract. We don't have a finished water contract. We do have an EPD permit allocation, but we don't have a straw or infrastructure in the ground to get that water independent of the City of Cumming. We now have a statement by the City of Cumming to discontinue providing the county raw water, and that statement basically manifests itself in two places. We have an August 24, 2012 letter to the chairman from the mayor indicating that there's no reason the county should receive raw water from the intake facility, and we also have a communication from the director of the Department of Utilities of the City of Cumming indicating that direction has been given to discontinue pumping raw water to Forsyth County effective October 1st, 2002. So therefore, in spite of our best efforts, I believe we are quickly heading toward a very bona fide dispute. And one, in fact, that may necessitate court action, or court involvement. And that is nothing that I'm necessarily happy about, but that is simply where we are. And the reason I bring this to you in an open session is simply because I wanted to explain why we may need to discuss this in executive session. The Open Meetings Act provides that not only may we discuss pending litigation in executive session, but we may also discuss potential litigation in executive session, so long as that potential litigation is discussed in good faith and it truly is potential. And I believe, regrettably, that we may be to that point. I will tell you that if we discuss potential litigation in executive session, that does not mean your hands are bound to tell anyone me to sue. You have the option to discuss it with your attorney and decide that's not where you want to go right now, but my recommendation is that we do go into executive session for that purpose, and I will make that request at the end of the meeting. You may ask, why am I talking about this now? The reason is because I don't have the luxury of going into executive session to talk to you about why we should go there, if you understand my point. I have to talk about that out here. I can't talk about that out there. But I'm saying it out here to say that's why I will make a recommendation that we do, and I'd seek your indulgence for that at the end of the meeting. Mr. Chairman, there's no action. Okay.
Would you recommend that we go into executive session now or at a later time?
Later time, Mr. Chairman, but I wanted to say it as a bona fide agenda item. I've done that. And at the end of the meeting, when the executive session would allow to be called, I will ask that we go into executive session to discuss both. Well, I think actually it's potential litigation, which is specifically authorized in the act.
And could I trouble you please to say again who the first document you referred to came from?
There's two documents I was specifically referencing. One was an October 24th, 2012 letter to you from the mayor of the city.
August.
Did I say September?
October.
August. Forgive me, Chairman. Commissioner Tam. August.
Thank you, Counselor. Then I believe at this point we're on to administrative hearings. And that will be administrative hearing number one. Tom?
Yes, sir. Members of the board, administrative hearing 1AI. Casimar Inc. This is a Sitco at Cummings Square. This is located in Commission District Number 3. And we're our first administrative hearing of the night. There is in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for Casimar Inc. doing business at Sitco at Cummings Square at 1410 Lynn Highway. The main licensee is the Avenue Draft Order. This hearing is for the main licensee, and in this case, a citation was issued for to the employee for underage sales, as well as a citation for an old sales ID. The letter, the certified mailing was signed and returned to our office. Thank you.
Thank you. Counsel. Counselor,
sir,
would you please just kind of walk people through that this would apply only to the people involved?
Absolutely. Mr. Chairman, I will. This next segment of the meeting is administrative hearings related to the Forsyth County Alcohol Code. These are administrative license hearings. These are not true public hearings in that any individual or member of the public can simply come up. These hearings are limited to only the actual licensee who wants to come up and explain mitigation, or an employee that may be subject to a sanction, or law enforcement that may want to come up and talk about the facts giving rise to the violation. So when open, the administrative hearing is commenced. The chairman will ask, after the case is made, the chairman will ask for the interested license holder or employee to approach the speaking podium, and at that point we would request that you stand up, present yourself, and come on up and ask any questions that the Board of Commissioners may ask you, or otherwise state your case or situation. Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. We've heard from Tom on 1A. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
So moved. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. That passes unanimously, and we are opening the administrative hearing for Gayatri Rathore. Are you here?
We gave enough training to them, made them sign every quarter. where they have to verify the positive verification of all the age. We try our best to keep the store clean, well stocked. Even in this economy, I've never had the gambling machines, not synthetic drugs, to increase the sales. Tried my best to keep the store well stocked, give good customer service, give them enough training to the cashiers regarding the sales of alcohol and tobacco. I'm sorry, it's sad, but unfortunately, we did get another citation.
You? Are there any questions?
All right. After getting the citation, you know, I've talked and tried several times before also, but now we've updated our registers where they have to enter the date of birth before they sell the alcohol. And we've also hired a company who comes every month to give them enough training on alcohol and sale of alcohol, and even hire a mystery shopper, which I'll be paying $40 every month. Even increase the hours of the cashiers, because this usually happens during the change of shifts or during closing of the store where they are in a hurry. And I personally feel that I've tried my best to give them enough training, but according to me, their penalty for whoever sells the alcohol to underage have to be increased, because that's very minimum. And I personally, as a business owner, feel that they really don't care, because they are not being paid $50 or $100 an hour. So they can, all they have to suffer is their alcohol IDs are taken away for 3 months, and then they can get it back and they can go and get the same job again. So they really don't care. But as business owner, I am the one who has to suffer all the loss, still pay the same mortgage, same utility bills, the payroll checks. So.
Ma'am, I ask you a couple of questions, please.
Sure.
And this Board of Commissioners, from time to time, discusses exactly what you're saying. We understand that you end up on the short end of the stick, if you will. But I'm also looking, there were two citations here, is that correct?
Yes.
And tell me what they were both for.
The first one was for alcohol, it is for the same thing, selling it to underage. And this one is for underage, as well as no alcohol ID.
As well as what?
No alcohol ID, but I have two cashiers. And during evening hours when it slows down, we have one cashier who runs the register and one is for cleaning and stocking. So one of the cashier who runs the register had gone to the restroom, and the other cashier had to do the sale, and that's when it happened.
If this falls back on you, maybe they should both have the ID.
Yes, but the other cashier usually comes and does the stocking and the cleaning up. She doesn't stay on the register. So that's when
but you see where it's important that you both have it. Tom, are there any others before these two? Or?
There was an underage sale citation that was issued on 4/20 of last year.
And can you tell us what the outcome of that was here?
A warning letter.
Where is the store located exactly? I'm trying to.
It's the one with the United States Postal Service across from Ford dealership.
They're centralized.
Isn't
that where the post office is?
Yeah, across from the Ford, go across from Billy Howell.
Yes.
So it's just north of Billy Howell on the opposite side of the road.
Yes.
Country Boy Trailers.
And it's a busy store.
Very busy store.
Yeah, very busy store, and I started it from ground up, given all my time, and just treated it like a baby.
Did you own it last year when it received the underage sale last year on April 20th? Were you the owner of the store?
Yes, sir. I've been running this store since 2004.
There are, and it's your option, you're the owner, because you take a lot of the risk here, like you said. That there are some professional companies out there that have professional training programs that you may want to consider.
I've already started it. I have this company, and they'll be sending mystery shoppers as well. And I'll be paying them $40 every time they come. And they come every month, and they'll be talking to the employees and training them.
So you actually have each and every employee go through the training program now?
Yes, sir.
Would you mind showing that contact? Mr. Brown may recognize them better than I do if they're one of the better-known companies.
This is one of the two companies the Board of Commissioners has identified as a official trainer.
Thank you.
TIRB.
Typically, in something like this, I may be a little less tolerant to some of the commissioners, except for this commission, he's even less tolerant than me. And I would consider something about 7 days on your second time around. But because you've taken the initiative to do that, I'm going to consider less. I'm not going to motion against it.
Thank you.
So, motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. Thank you. That passes unanimously. While you're thinking of that, Tom, let me ask you a question. This issue that the possibility that the employee, you know, may take a lackadaisical reference and they get penalized, lose their permit, and in a little while they get another one. I'm asking if you would consider, not necessarily right now, unless something pops into your head right now. I was wondering if for employees we might have actually a rating system of some kind in which somebody who has had lost their license or had infractions a few times, maybe it's a star, you know, a 4-star person is a person who's never had any issue, then you're 3-star if it's happened once, and 2-star, et cetera, so that the employer would have some idea, perhaps, of the risk that they're taking with an employee based on their history. Just something to think about.
Okay.
Go ahead, Tom. Sorry.
That's fine. And then again, the other question comes up for counsel. Are we allowed to share that information? Is it considered?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yes, sir. Mm-hmm.
In this instance, just like I said a moment ago, considering the initiative they've taken and understanding the risk that the owners do put up with, and when employees make bad decisions, it really does punish the owner of the company. But I'll make a motion in reference to the license holder on the zip code Cummings Square at 1410 Atlanta Highway, named licensee Gaetari Rathor, that we just do a 1-day suspension, and I will allow you to pick the day you would like that to be, but if you will please tell Mr. Brown. No, just 1 day. That's my motion.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. All those in favor, please vote. And all those not in favor, please vote. That passed unanimously. Okay. Next item is 1B, public supermarkets.
Yes, 1BI, Public Supermarkets, Inc., doing business as Public Supermarkets, Inc., number 26. Commission District number 5. This is administrative hearing in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for Public Supermarkets, Inc., doing business as Public Supermarkets, Inc., number 26 at 1735 Buford Highway. Named employee is Carlisle D. Pratt. This hearing is for the employee. The citation was issued for underage sales. The employee has no prior citations in the past 2 years, and in this case, the certified mailing and return receipt was not returned to our office.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the public hearing?
I'll move. Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Would someone from the public's, or is Carlisle here? I believe this is about you.
Yes.
So if you would, if you have anything to say or want to tell us about any of this, please come now. or your attorney, or a representative, that's fine.
Good evening. My name is Dan Cleta. I'm an attorney at Taylor Fall Parker, Olmsted and Hess, and I have the pleasure of representing Mr. Pratt and Hess at Public Supreme Martin, Inc., and his individual licensee, Mr. Martin Ford. This issue pertains to Mr. Pratt, noticing underage sales citation. Mr. Pratt has been a public employee for 1 year. This is his first citation, and this is actually his first citation for any sort of a good violation. Unfortunately, the citation was issued as a result of a mistake on Mr. Pratt's behalf in connection with trying to calculate the individual's age. He actually tried to do it in his head and miscalculated it, and he did not use the age verification system that Publix has on each of his cashier registers. If you've ever been to Publix, you may see when you present an ID, Publix cashier will punch in a birthday just to affirm whether or not somebody is 21. And unfortunately, he did not do this. If he would have done it, we probably would be here today. But following the citation, Mr. Pratt was returning. Publix does have its own internal secret shopper initiative, and within 30 days of returning, they did ensure that Mr. Pratt did successfully check ID. Mr. Pratt also did it before the magistrate court in January this year. He paid a $500 fine in addition to $175 in administrative court costs and fees. Finally, Mr. Pratt has agreed to exclusively use the automatic verification system. So really, the risk of this happening again is pretty minimal.
Thank you. Are there any questions from the board? Is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second. We have a motion to second. There's no discussion. Please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is this the Publix that's just at exit 14? No. This is the Publix.
This is off of Buford Highway, just east of 400.
East of 400.
Sackles.
Okay. All right. Well, this, according to the notes, this is my district, District 5. And this has happened just one time, it sounds like. And there have been steps, it appears, taken to try to make sure this doesn't happen again. So I would like to make a motion that we issue a warning.
Second.
Do that for employees.
Now
we've
got a minimum 30 days
for 4 weeks. Option good in this case.
It's motion second.
Then I'm left with no choice but to to suspend the license for 30 days. Is there a date that you would like this to start, or is there a date that
if we may commence that tomorrow, that'd be great.
Pardon me?
If we could commence it tomorrow, September 7th.
And run consecutively for 30 straight days?
Correct. Okay.
That's my motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Thank you very much.
You don't understand that was for that's the minimum we could do, maximum.
Yes, I do understand.
We are now at item B.
This is also located in Commission District Number 5. The administrative hearing is in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for Public Supermarkets, Inc., doing business as Public Supermarkets, Inc., number 26 at 1735 Buford Highway. The name licensee is Joseph Lamonte Formby. This is a follow-up hearing to the hearing we just conducted. This is for the name licensee. In this case, a citation was issued to the employee for underage sales. The return receipt was returned to our office for certified mailing. And I do need to call to your attention. In your books, it references that there is one other citation pending on this agenda, and that needs to be corrected. That citation is currently in state court, and there's not yet a finding or a plea of guilt So there is only one citation on record for this licensee at this time. Thank you.
Can you state that again?
Another, a second citation has been issued to Joseph Formby as a name licensee, but has not yet completed the court process. It went to state court, so it's going to take a little
while. Same location?
Actually, a different location.
What's the second location? You know?
I don't have that following since it didn't make it through tonight. I'm sorry.
Okay, that's all right. Different date then, obviously.
Different date, different location.
Okay.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second. I have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is Mr. Formby or the representative here? Yes, sir.
As you all just heard, this is in connection with the same citation issued to Mr. Pratt. If I may, I would like to really just briefly give you a little bit about the policies and procedures the OAS has in place, and then just tell you a little bit about the remedial measures that they took. The public, of course, does train all its employees with respect to the sale of restricted items. This spans beyond alcohol, also includes lottery tickets and tobacco products. Again, it's also the policy for them to use this age verification system, so that kind of should eradicate any errors with miscalculating a customer's age. Hooks does also have a very strict two-strike policy where an individual has two violations for a very sale, they could be subject to discharge. Hooks also makes it clear that individual employees are liable for the payment of a fine. In this case, it's only $700, so that's certainly a very large deterrent as well. Finally, Publix does have its own internal secret shopping program, and they actually conduct that it's underage checks internally once a month. And if an employee fails one of those checks, that's also a violation of possibly the T-Strike policy. In response to the citation, Publix did undertake an entire retraining of the sales force. In addition to the monthly sales checks that it does internally, it also ranked things up to do weekly checks, and they did this for a period of 2 months. Out of all of those internal checks, there was no other failure. They were all passed successfully. So based on that, and obviously through really strict policies and procedures against underage sales, we just asked for the money to issue this back.
Thank
you.
Are there any further questions on the board?
I would like to say one thing. Just you may want to consider if we watch another large supermarket chain do the same thing. They had one licensee from multiple stores, and they found how detrimental that would be. That would, if they lose a license in one, they've lost it all of them simultaneously. And it's something you consider to have a licensee in each location. It also helps to watch a little better if you found it.
Yeah, you'll have to take me through this. Earlier this evening, we made a change for Mr. Formby to be the license holder on one on Mathis Airport Road, that way. Is that right?
Oh, that's correct.
And he holds the one on Samples?
That's also correct.
How many more?
He's also the license holder at Keith Ridge Road, but his position is really a regional district manager. So he does go through and visit these stores routinely, and he does oversee them. As far as having one individual be licensed for each location, I do understand your concerns. But it also might allow him to kind of uniformly enforce alcohol license procedure because he is kind of one person who is ultimately responsible for each one of those locations.
So the set of violation that's pending is at a different location?
Yes,
which one is
that? That's at the Keith Ridge Road.
So he has three.
Just two. There's this underage sales matter.
No, I mean three stores that are supervising.
That's correct.
You supervise, how many do you supervise all together?
I have three in Forsyth County.
How many do you supervise all together?
Nine.
Nine.
Yes.
Mr. Forsyth, do you live in the state or in Forsyth County?
Yes, I live in Cherokee County.
Cherokee County.
Are you aware that if your license were to get suspended on one store, every store that you hold a license for would also be suspended?
I was not aware of that.
That's what I was trying to allude to.
I think that's what I...
So this is why sometimes they put the GM or one of the managers holds it, and they have a little more attaching responsibility to their store. One loses it, not everybody loses it.
Yeah, we hate to say there was a second or third violation where there was a mandatory suspension of 7, 10, or 30 days. Every store that you had a license for in Forsyth County would be subject to the same suspension.
So this is just coincidence that he's taking over the store on Mathis Airport Road?
That's correct. Yes.
If there are no further questions, is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
I'll move.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Okay, this is still in District 5. I would...
Before you guys, this is still considered the first citation, correct?
First citation. Our ordinance identifies 30 days, 0 to 30 days.
Thank you.
Is the record.
0 to 30.
On a side note, I'd like to say that I personally know that your corporation is very generous. It provides food to some of the places for people who need food as donations every day that it's possible. Some of the stores, not just once in a while. However, this is nevertheless a different issue, and it is very serious. But I believe that you are a responsible party and won't let this happen again. And also will consider strongly breaking up the license structure so that you don't we're not in a position where we have to really adversely affect your business. And in that vein, I'd like to make a motion that we just have a warning in this case.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you very much.
Item number C, Tom.
C, this is located in Commission District Number 3, Item CI. Administrative hearing in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for UBK2 Enterprises doing business as Alpharetta Food Mart at 5715 Atlanta Highway. The named employee is Suhakata Dasiri. This citation hearing is issued to the citation is for the employee, issued to the employee for underage sales. The employee has no prior citations in the last 2 years, and in this case, the certified mailing was not returned to our office.
You, for a motion to begin the administrative hearing, open it.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. There's no discussion. Please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is there a representative or is it Sudhakar here?
Mr. Brown, did you receive a letter from them?
Mailed it out, but it was never returned.
Did you receive a letter from them? And they were just what they'd like to do with this license?
We received a letter from the named licensee, which will come up in administrative hearing CIII C3. This is the employee that I do not have a record on file from the employee.
Thank you. We sent the letter to the employee, and they did not certify, and they did not, was not returned. Right. Didn't receive the assignment.
Is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Sorry.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. District 3.
This was just for the first person.
discussion, please vote. That passes unanimously. I think we're at CII.
CII, this is same outlet located in Commission District Number 3, an administrative hearing in reference to violations of alcohol ordinance for PBK2 Enterprises, Inc., doing business as Alpharetta Food Mart at 5715 Atlanta Highway. The named employee is Delmi Arsene. This hearing is for the employee. Citation was issued to the employee for underage sales. This employee has one prior citation for underage sales in the last 2 years. And similar to the last application, the certified mailing was not returned to our office.
Thank you, Tom. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is Delmi or a representative of that person here? See anyone? Is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. This is District 3 again.
Mr. Brown, they still have an obligation under the paper they signed to give any folding addresses, do they not?
Yes.
And can you please tell me on the second offense within 2 years? What our minimum and maximum is, please?
12 to 36 months.
12 to 36?
Correct.
So my minimum I'm allowed to do is 12 months?
Yes, for an employee with two underage citations.
And that's correct. And the motion in this case with the named employee, Delmi RSA or RC has 12 months suspension starting tomorrow morning. Second.
There's also a $10 fee for reinstatement too.
Well, that's already.
Yeah, but probably make that watch. Just make sure you know.
Tom, do I need to add that to it, or is that automatic and let the paperwork be signed?
Well, we process those just administratively.
Administratively will take place. Thank you.
We have a motion, we have a second. There's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. Tom, I think we're at CIII.
Yes, this is also in Commission District Number 3, the same outlet we just closed the administrative hearing on. This is in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for BBK2 Enterprises, Inc., doing business as Alpharetta Food Mart at 5715 Atlanta Highway. The name licensee is EJA Kruby. This hearing is for the licensee. In this case, there were two citations issued to employees of the outlet. Both citations were underage sales. The outlet has five prior citations. The certified mailing was returned to our office. And as Commissioner Levent indicated just a few moments ago, the name licensee has sent a letter to our office identifying they no longer wish to operate the business. They are returning their alcohol license back to Forsyth County. No longer wish to keep it and will not be attending this hearing.
Who's the, there's a new application that's been submitted. Is it the same corporation?
The business license staff is currently reviewing that right now to see if any of the same players are involved with this new application.
And that's, again, no. What do we do in a case like this?
That you take your, I don't think that the license holder can escape sort of the judgment of the board by simply trying to tender back the license. I think you open up the public hearing or the administrative hearing, and then I think you act accordingly based upon the number of infractions that they have, and if that in fact results in a revocation of the license, then I think that's all.
Because what if you say someone else is applying for a license right now, and we can't find any kinship or anything, but their friends or something, can we punish the store now?
I believe that there is language in the code that places a prohibition on getting a license at the location if there has been a disqualification or a revocation within a certain period of time. Am I still right on that, Tom?
There are a few sections of the code that relate to that issue, and I anticipate it'd be about one or two meetings out before that new item lands on your agenda. and I'll make sure we have all those relevant sections highlighted for the discussion.
We can accept the denial of the license.
The new one?
We could deny it.
That's right.
I mean, they don't get it just by virtue of applying for it. We could deny it.
That's right. And that's why we bring it to the board rather than processing and administering.
What's the revocation with the location? What is that within the code?
It used to be 5 years, Commissioner Bell. I don't remember if it's still five. It's been a long time.
The fact is, we know that they're just going to get a friendly license, and they're going to be doing the same thing. They've had 4 underage sales since August of 2011. So in a year, they listed here, they had one on August 12th of 2011, and another one on November 23rd, and another one on February 1st of 12, another one on June 6th of 12. In addition, they had 3 different citations on no IDs. They had 7 citations since February of 2011.
And the two we just dealt with, above the actual standard in itself, those are not listed below, are they?
Yeah.
And then one of the dates of 7.
That's the 4 days.
There are a total of 7 citations issued in this outlet.
And this is the kind of thing we see when we have all of these swags on hand, and we allow them to take their 4 days over the course of 6 months and do an hour or 2 a day. They don't take it seriously. They're just going to go get a friend and have the friend get a license and continue to know what they're doing.
Well, to be fair, their license was suspended for 60 days. That's pretty sure.
That's one of the longest ones I've ever been down at.
Yeah, it is.
Well, Tom said he's going to flag that license when he comes back so we can prove that.
I mean, they literally, by sending that letter, put up a surrender flag, I'm done, I realize that you're going to take my license, I don't want to come to the humiliation.
So you're going to revoke this or suspend it?
Let's close this.
I don't, we have it open to public, the administrator. Is there a motion to second?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. I assume is VJ or a representative of that person here? No one comes forward. Is there a motion to close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. District.
Under administrative hearing, alcohol ordinance for the BBK2 Enterprise in DBA Alberta Food Mart at 5715 Atlanta Highway, name licensee Ajay Kavari. I'm going to make a motion that we revoke their license. Also keeping in mind they sent a letter wishing to surrender as well.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. Thank you. Item number 2.
SDI, Commission District Number 3. Administrative hearing in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for Georgia Assets Inc. doing business as World Beverage at 5840 Gateway Drive. The named employee is Lavonda Cox. This hearing is for the employee. Citation was issued for underage sales as well as a citation for no sales ID. The employee has no prior citations, and the letter was returned as being undeliverable to the address mailed to.
Thank you. A motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is Lavonda Cox or representative here? Seeing no one come forward, is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that is closed. That passes unanimously. District 3.
Mr. Brown, are we looking at the only 2 citations for this individual?
That's right. 2 current citations. 1 underage, 1 no server ID.
And I can consider the no server as administrative?
Yes.
Okay. in this case of Lavonda Cox, I make a motion to redo the 30-day suspension. Starting tomorrow, 30 days consecutive.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Item number three, Tom.
Administrative hearing 1EI, located in Commission District Number 2. Administrative hearing is in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for Chopsticks Atlanta, Inc., doing business as Chopsticks China Bistro at 405 East Street Parkway, Suite 100. The name of the employee is Hugh Wang. This is a hearing for the employee. The citation was issued to the employee for underage sales. The employee has no prior citations in the last 2 years, and the certified mailing was not returned to our office.
Thank you. A motion to open the administrative hearing.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And it passes unanimously. Is Lee Wang or representative here for Chopsticks? Yes, sir.
Good evening. Bill Wang, my name is Paul Wang, the licensee.
You're not Hugh Wang.
Yeah. Okay. But I'm the limited licensee in these cases.
Yeah, I think we're going to take the employee first and then come to you. You're Paul, right?
Yes.
Yeah, you'll be next.
Motion to close.
Is there a motion to close the administrative?
Second.
Is there a
motion?
Second. We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no discussion, please vote, and that passes unanimously. District 2.
All right, so it's my understanding that we sent him a letter and we never received correspondence back. Is that right?
Correct.
Okay. We will suspend his alcohol license for 30 days starting tomorrow.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. If there's no discussion, please vote.
I thought we discussed in the past that it actually got, you said it did not get returned to you, which means they probably got the notice correct. And our notices now have a new language on them that state if you don't show up, what else could happen?
I don't think we got the return receipt.
Return receipt?
We did not get a return receipt.
No.
Yes, that's correct. Yeah.
If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. My numbering, I have paid with different numbering, but the next item is Paul Fine.
Yes. 1EII, Commission District Number 2. Administrative hearing in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for Chopsticks Atlanta, Inc., doing business as Chopsticks China Bistro at 405 East Street Parkway, Suite 100. Name licensees, Paul Hang. This is the hearing for the licensee to follow up to the hearing we just conducted. In this case, a citation was issued to an employee for underage sales. The outlet has no prior citations in the last 2 years, and the certified mailing was signed and returned to our office.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second. We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Paul, if you'll come forward now, please. You want to tell us what happened?
The employee in this case, Q1, he didn't inspect the license, the driver license, but somehow he carefully enough. Because when they apply for work, I was given training on it. Like, if they stay in the age, they say the license should be in a vertical, not in a house sizes. But somehow, he did inspect it, but did not pay attention to it. And so that's how it's happening.
You're the main licensee?
Yes, sir.
Do you manage the facility?
I'm sorry?
Do you manage the business?
Yes, sir.
All right, have you never had a infraction before?
I have no record in the last 2 years of infractions.
You've been open about 3-4 years?
Yes, Chopsticks, yes. It's been 3.5 years. It's end of my name, yes.
Is this the only location you have?
Yes, Charles, that is not me. I do own another business, but this has been closing now in Forsyth County. I sold the business 2 years ago.
Sold the business 2 years ago?
If you don't mind, does this employee still work for you?
No, he's no longer working in the company.
Any further questions, Mr. Chairman? Motion to close the public.
I will just ask, make sure. Do you understand what can happen if you get a second violation in 24 months?
Yes, I do, sir. I know what happened is, since I asked them to really care when a customer was coming in and servicing alcohol.
Okay, so what steps would you say you've taken to make sure this doesn't happen again?
Well, I've been going to the training classes, but it's been the very first day where we applied for the licensing. So we've been training on it, and when new employee comes in, I do follow with the ordinance to train an employee to other processes, check him on the alcohol ID.
All right, we have two approved vendors. Is that right, Tom?
Yes.
Two approved vendors that will come in and educate the employees.
Yes, sir.
And give you a certificate of completion, correct?
Correct.
Yes.
All right. I guess I'll wait till we close the hearing.
Are there any further questions for Paul? If not, is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
So moved. Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. District 2.
Okay. This is your first violation, which means you could lose the license for up to 30 days. Understand?
Yes, sir.
Okay. This is what I'm going to ask that the board rule, and that is that we issue a warning and that you complete one of those two.
I did have the training from TIRB. Yes.
TIRB is one of the identified vendors, and we've seen in the past where the commissioners have required a retraining for the entire staff.
When was the last time you did that?
April 16, 2010.
Yeah, you need to redo that.
I'm sorry?
You need to recertify it, yes, because chances are a lot of your employees have come and gone,
yes,
over that time, right?
Mm-hmm.
So within the next 60 days, you need to get a certificate of completion to the Planning Community Development Department.
Yes, sir.
Agreed?
Yes.
Mr. Tampa, just to make sure I'm clear, will that be for the entire, all people with all sales ID or for name licensee only?
It's for all people with sales ID in there. Okay,
yeah.
So you have one big class.
Yes, sir.
All right, and I think they actually teach it when you're a tech, which isn't far from you. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they'll teach it over there.
Mr. Tam, I think I understand the motion, but that makes them some conversation too. Would you mind just restating?
My motion is that we issue a warning. And we also ask that he and his staff be recertified on one of the under 21
raise requirement in the next 60 days to complete.
Within the next 60 days and present a certificate of completion to your top.
I'll second that.
We have a motion, we have a second. There's no further discussion. Just a second. Can we close the public hearing, the administrator hearing? There's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. Thank you. The next item is Lamaro 712. I'm sorry, Lamaro 12.
Yes. This is item 1FI, located in Commission District Number 2, an administrative hearing in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for Lamaro 12, doing business as Laredo's Mexican Bar and Grill at 405 Peachtree Parkway, Suite 165. The name of the employee is Jose Campos. The hearing is for the employee, and the citation was issued for underage sales, as well as a citation for no ID. The employee has no prior citations identified in the last 2 years, and the certified mailing was signed and returned to our office.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
Move. Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. Is Jose Campos here or a representative?
Good evening, my name is Jose Campos, and I work for Loretta's Mexican Brew in 2011. I worked there for 6 months. I worked there as a busboy. I was not a waiter. The manager that was with me was Abraham Baca. He's here today, but he's not in the MCC. It's Juan Jose Morales. What happened was that January 11th, 2011. It was around about 7:30. It was just me and the busboy and two other servers. The manager that was new to Abraham Baca, he sent one of the servers home. So it was just me. It was me as a busboy and the server. And around 7:30. 8 o'clock, we are really busy, and the server that was on duty, he couldn't handle any more tables, so he asked me to take a order to this table. So I didn't know what to do, so I was trying to help him. So I went to the table and I asked what they wanted to drink, but I did forget to ask them for ID, because I didn't have any serving experience at the time. You know, I was just a busboy. So I took the orders. No, I do have access to the computer. The busboys at the restaurant takes the orders. So I went, I put the drinks in, and I gave it to the undercover cops that were there. I brought the drinks to them, and pretty much what happened, they told me they had to go. They had an emergency. My manager asked me, why did they leave? I told them I didn't know what was going on. You know, I was in the back. You know, I was cleaning the bathroom, and suddenly the server that was there, he told me to go up in the front because there was a cop that wanted to talk to me. And at that time, you know, I was really scared. You know, I was like, so I went up there. You know, he just told me that. He's like, should you take the drinks to them? And I told him, I asked manager on duty, I was like, you know, what should I do? What should I tell him, you know? I was trying to help, you know, I wasn't getting in trouble or anything. And he told me, yeah, he gave me two citations about selling. So I'm calling to a minor and having not having an ID.
Can you tell me, are you still employed there?
I'm sorry?
Are you still working there?
No, I do not. He fired me at the spot.
You currently have a foreign license, a liquor license, a service license?
No, I don't. I don't have one.
Let me ask you, if you tell me, if you had, what do you think would have happened if you had said to him, no, I'm not going to take the orders?
Well, I wouldn't be standing here today if I told him that. I was just trying to help him because we got so busy because the server that was new, he left. So
I just wanted to make sure that you're not saying that something would have happened to you if you had refused.
Who asked you to actually go help? Who?
The other server. He told me to go over there.
A different server than the
one left. Yeah, right, correct, sir.
Thank you. Any other questions? Is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. You can sit down if you'd like to. District 2.
How do you take something away and have?
I have a present server license. I think what we've done in the past is we have asked, to the extent the board wanted to go ahead and take action, We have flagged the file, and if the individual came in for a future license, we have acquired a 30-day delay for the continuing.
And you can just start the 30 days now. If it comes in the next 30 days, it can't get it, it's up to you how you want to do it.
I mean, this is a weird one. I mean, how was he supposed to necessarily know if he couldn't do this? That's really where you get into a management, more of a management issue.
It is.
Yeah, all right. Fair enough.
Now, I just put a stay on his license until October 7th.
What do you mean by that?
That he couldn't get one.
So it's suspended for 30 days.
He doesn't have one.
He can't apply for it.
He can't get one for the next 30 days.
So you're putting a stay on the issuance of the new license?
Yeah. Yes, for the next 30 days.
Yeah, but wait a minute. I'm not sure in the...
It's a suspension that actually stay.
Yeah, but it doesn't say we can do that here, I don't think, does it?
We can suspend it for 30 days.
Suspend what?
His license.
Yeah, then have a license.
Suspended.
If he had one.
How about suspend the opportunity for application?
How about we say this guy got pushed against the wall, doesn't have a license, has had apparently to pay some sort of fine, and be done with it?
Yeah, but we've got to do something with his license.
He doesn't have one.
He doesn't have a license?
Jim's wrong.
I know. So
how do you have to do something to a license he doesn't have?
So we are putting a stay on it for 30 days. He can't go get one.
The question that was asked is how we handled this before. I was simply providing the guidance. That's the way I know we've handled it before. That's not the only way we would have to handle it, but we have done that.
Or we could do nothing because he doesn't have a license. We could suspend.
I mean, look at it from his point of view, from what he said. He was trying to help out. He was cleaning a restroom when the cops finally somebody called him out there. He was trying to help his employer. He didn't know he needed one. The employer didn't bother to tell him one. It was super busy, which is why he was trying to help out. And he immediately gets fired.
Yeah, we don't have anything to do with him getting fired.
Yeah,
but he's also probably paid some sort of a fine, you know.
And
I'm saying, I mean, on the one hand, we've had somebody else before talk about, you know, how employees don't care, and then we have a fellow like this come along, and you go, I'd like to hire this guy if I own the place.
Mr. Chairman, ask a question for everybody. Mr. Brown, this occurred in 2012 with respect to the alcohol or the employer server license. Is it in fact expired? Was it turned back in?
He was just helping out.
Yeah, we plan to try to go get one here in the next 30 days.
Yeah, I'm currently working in a different restaurant now. I'm going to go on server. So that's why I came here.
You're a server now?
No, I'm not a server now. I work both ways in a different restaurant.
He's trying to be something besides a busboy.
All right, so are you planning on being a server?
Well, eventually, yes.
Next 30 days?
No, I mean, not on the next 30 days.
Okay, to serve alcohol, you know, you have to be 18 years old.
I know, that's right. All
right, we're just getting all the little gun.
Mr. Moff, if he does this stay or hold on the license for 30 days, it's not going to affect it one way or the other. And I understand you have a compassion to protect them.
The ordinance doesn't allow for a stay. I think we just
are you just a busboy now in lieu of this case? Is that why you haven't been made a server, because this has been hanging over you?
No, sir. I have a different situation, but I don't want to stay right here, like right now.
Okay.
Because I don't think it's inconvenient to be here right now.
Can we suspend something he doesn't have? I mean, that's...
No, you can't suspend a license he doesn't have. I agree with that. The only accommodation we've done in the past is for the 30-day stay. But again, that's not the only way we can handle it.
Could we have this way, just hold his license October 7th? Is something wrong with that?
Or we can just send him to jail.
What? He's kidding.
I'm kidding.
you all would have it. If you were to put a stay until he's reapplying in 30 days, that would be...
All right, well, I'll tell you what. How about, when are you planning on becoming a server?
I don't know, to tell you the truth.
You got no plans right now, sir?
I'm gonna become a server on the restaurant that I work soon. I mean,
Commissioner Tamlin, maybe you talk to him offline, maybe he can explain to you that and explain to everybody your process.
How about this? I'll withdraw my motions.
I'll
second. All right, well, I'm gonna put a stay on for 10 days to prevent you from getting a license for 10 days. But when you get to be a server, you need to have a license. Understand?
Yes, sir.
I'll second for 10 days.
We have a motion. We have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes 4-1. Thank you. The next part is about the named licensees, huh?
Correct. Administrative hearing 1FII, Commission District Number 2, administrative hearing in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for Lamar 12, doing business as Laredo's Mexican Bar, Verlai 405, East Street Parkway, Suite 105. Named licensee is 1, Jay Morales. This is a follow up administrative hearing to the hearing you just conducted. This hearing is for the licensee. In this case, a citation was issued to the employee for underage sales, as well as another citation for lack of a sales ID. The outlet has no prior citations in the last 2 years, and certified mailing was re-signed and returned to our office.
Thank you, Tom. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
Totally.
Second. We have a motion and a second. There's no discussion. Please vote. That passes unanimously. Is Juan Jose Morales and or a representative here? And if so, please come down to the podium. Please tell us who you are and...
Good afternoon, Commissioners. My name is Juan Morales. I do hold a license from the restaurant. I have on the license here on... We have 4 Laredos and 2 in Cobb County and 2 here in Forsyth County. 1 in Key Bridge Road, but that license is not in my name now. I sold the restaurant. And I hold the license for since 2006 for Key Bridge into a year ago. But I do hold this license since 2008, I believe. And we do hold training for all the restaurants. And this kid, he was a good worker. He was trained, he holds a certificate 2 months before when this happened. This kid was taking the to-go orders. And 2 months before this happened, they were trained by a company, along with the other store in Heath Ridge Road. All the waiters were trained by a company because they were thinking about promoting to be a waiter. But he was trained on the procedure on liquor sales, even though he wasn't a waiter. But he was trained. But all the waiters, we don't make them waiters just without a license. And the waitress that was there, and this the kid was fired that day. But with all the waiters, we train on liquor sales.
Are you saying that the busboy actually was trained?
He was trained even though he wasn't a waiter.
So he knew better.
Better about that. 2 months before this happened.
No, I mean, that's like saying we trained this guy to be a pilot, but we never gave him a license, and he crashed the plane, but it's his fault.
No, I'm not saying that it's his fault, but I'm just telling you the background. That he is a good worker, but the manager fired him along with the waitress that was in charge of serving the table.
I mean, you think he just arbitrarily said, I think I'll start acting as a server now, or did somebody ask him to do that?
He told you the truth that he was asked to help because they were busy.
Did they know he did not have a server license?
He knew that, and then the other waiter.
The employee that you get.
That still isn't going to allow you to jump on the road and find out the correct permission for that person.
I mean, I know the consequences when this happened, even though we hire companies to train this, for this case. I know that if we lose the license, you know, people when they come to at the restaurant, you know, they ask you, if we lose the license, they're not going to come and eat there. And like I was telling you, we have four Laredos and two in Cap County and two in here.
Two in Forsyth County?
Two in Forsyth County.
Have you ever had a violation?
Never, sir.
Forsyth County, how long have they been?
This location, I had the license on my name on since 2008. And I had the other location was in my name until a year ago, since 2006. So I never had a violation in my name.
But it's not in your name now?
No, I sold I had two partners, and the other two partners is still on that store, and the new partner has the license under her name.
Where is this one?
One is exit 14, right across from the avenue.
13.
Yes, 13. And the other location is in exit 17, Hebrews Road.
Okay, that's
right. But I know that this is, I'm not new on this, but the kid was trained, even though he wasn't a waiter, 2 months prior to this thing happened. Okay. Thank you.
All right. I'm going to
close. Is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. That passes unanimously. Mountain District 2.
Yeah, I'm going to recommend that. Well, first of all, do you understand what happens if you get another violation?
Yes, sir.
I'm going to recommend that we give you a warning for this, and that you're required to retrain the staff in the one that you have the license, you hold the license in. And submit that certificate of completion to this gentleman here for the next 60 days.
Okay.
Second.
We have a motion, we have a second. There's no discussion.
Before we act on that motion, could I have clarification if this is internal corporate training or if it's required training?
No, this is two approved vendors.
Thank you.
Two approved vendors. This guy can help you who they are, okay?
Okay.
Is that your second?
I just want to
have a motion. We have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. The next item is North Star Dining Room. Tom?
Yes, thank you. Public hearing, administrative hearing 1GI, District 2, administrative hearing violations, in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for North Star Dining Group, Inc. Doing business as Ichiban Steak and Sushi at 410 Peachtree Parkway, Suite 112. The name of the employee is Wee Man Zhu. This hearing is for the employee. In this case, the employee was issued a citation for underage sales. The employee has no prior citations in the last 2 years. And the certified mailing was signed and returned to our office.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion to second. If there's no discussion, please vote. That passes unanimously. Is Women's Zoo or a representative here? Please come down. Please tell us your name and what happened.
Good evening, guys. My name is Women's Zoo. In Queensway, the North Star Dining Group. At this time, it's a busy house, and I've had much experience in this restaurant because I'm just working for several days. I still need a very soon because at the time it's the busy times and several tables and the customers need orders for the if that means that Henry, we can come here and you help us all at times. So I'm very busy, but I don't need to do that because I close the guest commission to contribute that because I know so it's my also. But it's, I think it's good. How does it? So now I've changed my business, so better as I'm not working in this very well. This is my first time.
Any questions?
How long have you worked there?
I'm sorry?
How long have you worked there?
Okay.
Worked there, how long? 6 months? A year?
Not too much.
Do you work there now?
No.
You don't work there. When did you stop working there?
After 1 week. Only 1 week.
After what?
One week.
1 week.
You worked there 1 week?
Yeah.
Are you working anywhere now?
Certain tips?
Sorry.
You're not working anywhere now? Waiting tips? No.
Do you still serve?
I just look at an office job, so I'm an office job. And they restate.
Is there any more questions? If not, is there a motion to close the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second. There's a motion second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion. And that passes unanimously. District 2.
All right, well,
does he still have his license?
Sounds like not at this outlet. Do you have a license at another outlet? Are you currently serving alcohol?
Yes, I have a license.
I think he said his office job. I think he said it's on real estate.
We'll check our records and if there's a suspension that will apply to any license he has at another outlet.
We're required, the minimum that we have is that we suspend your license for 30 days. I don't know that you're using one actively.
Mr. Chairman, Commission, I do have someone in the audience that can translate for us to make sure he understands what you're telling
him.
If you'd like to do that.
Dan, is that okay?
Yes.
Yes, it is okay.
Thank you.
Who are you?
Good evening, Mr. Commissioner. Actually, I am the president of Star Bank Group.
Okay.
My name is Johannes Lard.
Does he work for you now?
No, he doesn't, sir.
You know if he works anywhere else serving alcohol?
Not that I know, but he quit about a week after he got his violation.
Okay. And can you ask him if he has an alcohol permit anywhere else now?
This time I move that we suspend his license for 30 days.
So, immediately.
Starting tomorrow.
So, we have a motion. We have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion. That passes unanimously. Thank you very much. Tom, the next item.
Yes, administrative hearings 1GI, Commission District Number 2. The administrative hearing is in reference to violations of the alcohol ordinance for North Star Dining Group. Inc. doing business at Digibound Steak and Sushi at 410 Peachtree Parkway, Suite 112. The name licensee is Hung Young Moo. The hearing is for the licensee and is the follow-up hearing to the hearing just completed in which an employee was issued a citation for underage sales. The outlet has no prior citations in the last 2 years and certified mailing must sign and return to our office.
Thank you. Is there a motion to open the administrative hearing?
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, please vote on the motion.
My name is Kim, M-U-H, last name, and I'm the owner of the Ichion restaurant. Yes, it is.
You are the name licensee and the owner of this place.
Yes, sir, yes, sir.
Can you come up here, stand next to him for just a moment? All right, so is he Kim Young-mu?
Is it Kim Young?
Yes, Kim Young-mu, yes, yes.
That's you?
Yes.
All right, and how long have you been open?
We're selling a two-store, one at the Winnow property, and this is the Forsyth. Both shirts from where we opened probably, one in Winnow's hanging, and this is like 4.5 years.
4.5 years?
Yes. 10 and 1.5 years, so that's what I said, yes.
You're at the Avenue, right?
Yes, sir, right. Never had it in, trying to just train, you know.
All right, have you done any mass training as a group for your staff there?
Yes.
And actually, like right now for the future, we're trying to hire a server who already like had the security condition for the alcohol training on the Forsyth County. And if they don't have one, we're trying not to hire them. And then also, we try to enforce them. Even if they already have one, and then we hire them, and then if they try to violate the ordinance, and then we're going to try to release them in place. So, that's the enforcement we're trying to do.
Okay. Are you aware of what can happen if you get another violation?
Yes, sir. We are aware that our license can get suspended or revoked. But like he said, like we had two stores, and then this never happened with us before. But things are happening sometimes. Get very hard to control, especially during the busy hours. And then, like I said, we try to enforce all the policy and rules. Yes, sir.
So this is what I'm going to recommend. So we give you a warning this time. That you comply with training your staff with one of these two approved vendors that this gentleman here will tell you.
We're not in court.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Is there a motion?
He can explain it.
Well, he can.
It's not part of your motion. I mean, he can explain it.
No, I'll go right now. That's fine. Let's have to do it. We're closing this right here.
Is there a motion to close it? Okay. We have a motion.
Second.
We have a motion. We have a second. If there's no further discussion, we can vote on the motion. That passes unanimously. And now, I'm sorry.
It's all right. I'm going to move that we give you a warning, okay? And that you get with this gentleman here, and that you comply with having one of the two qualified or groups that we use so that the county has signed off on to train your staff, and you present a certificate of completion within 60 days. So, understood?
Yes, sir.
Understood. Yes, sir.
We have a motion. Do we have a second?
Second.
You understand if you get another violation, you can lose your license for a long time.
We do, yes, sir.
Okay. Make sure you know.
Thank you.
We have a motion. We have a second. If there's no further discussion, please vote on the motion, which passes unanimously. That brings us to the end of the agenda, except,
Chairman,
do we have need of an executive session?
Well, we do, but before we get there, I may have some unfortunate news. I'm not sure that's unfortunate, only because of the length of the meeting. With respect to the BBK2 Enterprises matter, I believe Mr. Vijay B. Kaburi is now here, and I think at least for perfecting the record, he doesn't know what has happened to his license. This was the one that I believe the Board of Commissioners revoked, and I also believe it was the one where the license holder, I understood, had actually tendered their license back to the county. So I believe, Mr. Chairman, respectfully, at least for purposes of perfecting where we are with this license, I would request that, not that we reconsider anything, but that at least this individual be able to come down and we can sort through exactly what we believe has occurred this evening. My understanding is this individual, on behalf of this license, tendered their license back to the county in addition to having it revoked earlier because of the number and severity of the offenses. Would that be appropriate for this gentleman to be asked to come down to the podium?
Yeah, I want to make sure under what guise. Is just a gracious thing or
Well, I think for the purpose of simply clarifying in this open session what in fact they occur, what in fact has occurred, then I guess they missed. I guess they were not here because you sounded the item and asked for the gallery.
Since it was my district, may I suggest that he comes down, you explain what took place and why we made the decision. Also, maybe Mr. Brown will read the letters, he understands. I don't think all of us can do all the Q&A and back and forth. It looked pretty crazy.
It should be settled. I mean, this matter has already been decided. Mr. Vijay Kaburi, please come down, please. Mr. Kaburi, for the record, would you please state your name?
My name is Vijay Kaburi.
And Mr. Kaburi, are you the license holder for VBK2 Enterprises, Inc., DBA Alpharetta Food Bar?
Yes, sir.
Mr. Kaburi, this evening, your matter was on the agenda. You are the name licensee, and the board was presented with multiple citations, both for underage sales, four current underage sales violations, as well as three no ID on premises violations. This matter was sounded, in other words, it was called, your name was called. Have you just arrived here recently to the hearing?
I came around 5:30, and I came all the way from South Carolina to attend the meeting. I got some important call, that's why I went outside. I waited for 3 hours, I'm sorry for missing. Last time also, I came in, attended, my license was suspended for 60 days. After that, I never sold any alcohol, and I sold my business. I wrote a letter to Ms. Deborah to surrender my license. Today also I came all the way to respect your county procedures. I came all the way from South Carolina to keep my license, telling that I no longer present here and my employee did without my absence. That's why I want to tell I respect your county procedures. That's what I am trying to tell you. And I canceled all my trips. Suspend my all other works to respect your call.
Mr. Kaburi, I want you to understand one of the things the Board of Commissioners heard this evening was that a letter has been received by the county where you did in fact tender your license back to the county. Mr. Brown, do you have that letter at your disposal?
I do.
Mr. Brown, would you be kind enough, and I just want on the record, would you be kind enough to read the letter so Mr. Kaburi can hear it?
Yes. I have already attended my hearing in connection with the employee violation of June 6th of this year. At that hearing, my alcohol license was suspended until September 8th. I do not understand why you have written me requiring another hearing to determine suspension or revocation when the license was already suspended. As you know, I have decided to no longer keep this business. I cannot count on employees of Forsyth County to do their jobs properly. I have already informed my landlord, and it is my understanding that he has found a new tenant. It is also my understanding the new tenant has applied for his licenses. I will no longer be operating the business. With this letter, I am returning my alcohol license back to Forsyth County. I no longer wish to keep it. Therefore, I will not be attending the second hearing in connection with this issue. I certainly appreciate your assistance, and I have really enjoyed doing business in Forsyth County. It is unfortunate that I did not find good employees in the area. With kindest regards, I am Vijay Kaburi.
Mr. Kaburi, did you tender that letter to Forsyth County?
Yeah, I sent a letter to Ms. Deborah. She told whether I had to attend, I don't have to attend. And she did not give me confirmation. That's why I came all the way this evening to respect you, your policies, and to came to submit in face. Because my advisor told no need to attend because I already sold out the business. I no longer sold the business after the hearing because 60 days the license was suspended. We never sold anything. And September 8th is tomorrow, and already sold out the business. Still, I want to respect you, your procedures. I came all the way to show that, and I want to show my sincerity for your letter.
Well, thank you. And for you, he's saying that was his letter, and that he has sold the business, and he has not sold any alcohol during the 60-day time frame, and it's up this Saturday. and that because he didn't get confirmation that Mr. Brown received the letter, out of respect for us, he decided to show up.
Okay, I concur. That's what I heard as well. And I think, Mr. Curry, the reason we had you down, your hearing is already concluded. The board did, in fact, not only take you up on your offer of tenders back, but the board did revoke your permit. So there's really no other business for you to have in front of the board, but I did want you to understand it is appreciated you've attended this evening, but your matter has been decided.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Okay, Councilor, do we have any other executives? Are there any other pieces of business to come forward?
Chairman, I have no other business. I do request an executive session. It is for the purpose of discussing potential litigation. Given that I only have one topic that I will be discussing with you, Commissioner Amos, I would respectfully request you continue your recusal on that item because it will be discussed the City County Water matter under potential litigation.
Yes, sir. Is there a motion to recess this regular meeting in order to begin a motion. Do we have a second? Second. We have a motion. A second. If there's no discussion, please vote. And that passes unanimously. We are recessed at 7:54 p.m. to go into executive session.
Mr. Chairman, I would want to say that I do not anticipate us coming out and taking any official action other than to close the meeting.